Okay. Now, before we begin, we need to kind of go through and touch upon some key questions here. The first, all Arabs are Muslims. True or false? Probably recognize that, of course, any true false, you know, statement with the word all in it is false. And this is another example. This is false. Muslims are Arabs. They're also Caucasians. They're also Asians, Africans. Islam is a worldwide religion. So, then what is an Arab? And an Arab is a group of people that when you go in and look at their descent, they have their roots, they're a Semitic group of people, just like the Jews today, who lived in the present day Mideast. Okay? They're Christian Arabs, Jewish Arabs, and Muslim Arabs. Right? So when we use this word Arab, it doesn't automatically refer to somebody who is Muslim. There's all those different ones. And there's about 3.5 million Arabs living in the United States today. And again, Arabs are Christian, Jewish, and Muslim. Don't confuse Arab with the religion of Islam. Don't do that. Now, here's a fun question. Which country today has the largest Muslim population? Think about it. What country today has the largest Muslim population? You might guess, say for example, Saudi Arabia, right? Or Iran, right? Those might be good guesses, but you'd be wrong. Indonesia. What's Indonesia? If you're not familiar with it, you can Google it. It's a nation of islands. It's an archipelago that's just north of Australia. Yeah, that's a really cool thing. Now, all Muslims are terrorists. False. False, false, false. Islam is a religion of peace. Now, a lot of people today spend so much time connected to the media, they in essence become brainwashed. So hopefully one of the things throughout this course is you'll kind of scrape away all of the soot and smoke and filth that's been put there on your filter, your perception by the media. And this is one of the things you really need to scrape off. And people, you know, say, well, is Christianity a religion of peace? If you look throughout history at all of the things, the violent acts that have been done in the name of Christianity, this question oftentimes can be, you know, it raises the eyebrows, right? So now, what does the word Muslim mean? What does the word Muslim mean? One who submits to God. So if you submit yourself to God, in other words, if you're strong enough to take your own will and stomp it down and to put the will of God in place of your will, then guess what you are? You fit the definition of a Muslim. Yeah, that's so great. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to travel to 650 Common Era. And you can tell by the map here, this is the Arabian Peninsula. And at this time, there was a man, his name is Muhammad, who was 40 years old, and he was praying to Allah. And Allah, that is the Arabic word for God. And he was in a cave outside of Mecca. So this is Mecca. He was in a cave outside of Mecca. And a lot of people say, well, what's the big deal, Mr. K, about a man praying to God? During this time and this area of the world, the people had backslid. They had stopped worshiping God, and they had become polytheists. Remember, poly means many. they were worshiping many different gods. They were worshiping false gods. And this part, one of the main practices was idol worship. And it was really, really popular. And this really bothered Muhammad, that this whole group of people had turned away from the faith of their ancestors. So it really bothered him, so he was praying to God. And then, one day, the angel Gabriel, right, this is different spelling, a little different pronunciation, the same angel Gabriel, right, this is Gabriel, who also appeared unto the Virgin Mary, and let the Virgin Mary know that she was going to give birth to a child we call Jesus. Now, the same angel appeared unto the prophet Muhammad and revealed to the prophet Muhammad that he was to be a messenger of God. And what the angel Gabriel told the prophet Muhammad to do was to recite. Now, here's something that's so cool. I always like to liken this. So what the prophet Muhammad did, he recited the Holy Quran. It was delivered unto him, right? If you're a prophet, you don't come up with your own idea. You're just a conduit. So the Holy Quran came from God, was delivered unto him, and then he opened up his mouth, and then he recited the Holy Quran. It's an amazing story. So again, who else did the angel Gabriel appear to with the message? And it's the Virgin Mary. So when we talk about the prophet Muhammad, when he was alive, he was known to be devoted to God. He was a merchant and a trader. He was married and a father, and he was illiterate. So a lot of people say, well, if he was illiterate, Mr. K, how did he write this? And the answer is he didn't. He recited the Holy Quran. And then he found scribes to record it. And then once they did, he said, read it back to me so I can make sure that you've got this message right. And he was known as the Trusted One. Now, when the prophet Muhammad first heard Gabriel's command, he was very hesitant, because you can imagine, if you're praying to God in a cave and an angel appears unto you, chances are you might think that you're hallucinating, that you might have gone crazy. So that he was really, really hesitant, and he really didn't know what to do. So what he did is he shared the message with his wife and family and close friends. And here's a really cool story. When the prophet Muhammad shared what had happened with his family, he had an aunt who was a Christian. So they went and found this aunt, and then he told the aunt what had happened, said, did this really happen? And she said, well, describe this to me. And then she said, yes, you've had an authentic experience with an angel. This is indeed the word of God, right? So this is so cool. So then after the prophet Muhammad, you know, got over this hesitation and this fear that he had, then he began his public ministry. He began preaching in Mecca. What did the prophet preach? There is one God. He told people that they had to turn away from idol worshiping, from worshiping these false gods, and to worship Allah. Here's a little tidbit here. There were more than 300 gods being worshipped in the Arabian Peninsula at this time, which is just amazing, mind-boggling. It told people that they had to live a moral life in the eye of God. And what the Prophet Muhammad was trying to do, he was trying to change society to help the poor and the outcasts. Now, here's something, right? When we had our overview of Christianity and we looked at the ministry of Jesus of Nazareth, the people that he was reaching out to, who were those people that Jesus was reaching out to? The poor, right? the outcasts. Hey guys, Muhammad is doing the same thing. He's trying to reach out to the same group of people and said that Allah will judge all on the day of judgment. So what happens is that Muhammad attracts followers and his popularity grows, just like Jesus of Nazareth. And just like Jesus of Nazareth, the people who are in power, right, at the top of the social pyramid, are suspicious of the Prophet Muhammad. The Prophet Muhammad generates controversy. People start to get angry with him and persecute him. And a lot of people today go, why? He's just a good guy doing a good thing. Well, now here's something important to remember. If you're talking truth to power, in other words, if you're upsetting social order, right? The people at the top of the social pyramid, the 1%, are going to do what they can to stomp you out, right? And that's what happened with Jesus of Nazareth. Now, so what the Prophet Muhammad did, he left Mecca. It got so dangerous for him that he got his followers and they left Mecca for Medina. Now, then he assumed new roles. Not only being a prophet, but he also became a political leader and a social reformer. Now, a good way to liken this for Americans, the role of Muhammad is, if you were to take Jesus, George Washington, and Abraham Lincoln, and roll them into one person, that's Muhammad, all of those roles. So then conflict breaks out between Mecca and Medina.